So broadly, these are concept of cost. Now, let me just throw some numbers on this so that, you know, the concepts are a little clear. Now, I'm going to start this pizza factory. Hmm. Yeah. And I've just bought the land and machinery, everything. Now, I'm going to start production. Initially, I have bought this factory shed, as well as I have also purchased the machinery for making pizza. Mm. So that's the initial investment that is going as 30 euros or $30 or whatever it is. Mm. So then we are looking at, you know, that's a fixed cost. Mm. With this $30 or euros or whatever currency that we are using, you can produce up to certain level of pizzas. Mm. So maximum, I think I can go up to 200 pizzas.
Okay.
Per hour.
Okay.
But depending on my demand, I will vary my production. Hmm. So initially, I have not hired any worker.
Hmm.
I have just bought the machinery, hmm, installed it.
Hmm. Okay. But you don't do it yourself. You just bought a machinery.
Bought a machinery.
So far, no demand.
No demand, and I have not started my operations. Okay. But please remember, even at that point, I have incurred a cost. That is the cost of
the
machinery, and that's a fixed cost.
Right.
Okay. Now, then I thought that, okay, I'll hire one worker. Hmm. And this worker is quite okay, produces 50 pizzas per hour.
Okay.
Then there is a marginal product of this labor, that is this one worker is producing 50 units of output, that's the marginal product of that laborer whom I have hired. So the concept of marginal product becomes very important here. Then my cost of factory remains same. Mm. It does not vary because it's a one-time factory investment that I have made. Mm. Okay. Cost of workers, I have to pay this worker salary or wage, no, daily wage or whatever it is. So I'm giving $10 or 10 euros for that. So then my total cost actually increases. 30 euros I have already incurred for factory, and 10 I have already labor. Now please remember, I have not added the material cost. Right now I have some material with me, I'm producing with that.
Okay.
So material, this, to keep it very simple kind of a thing. We can complicate it with material cost, energy cost, all variables. Then I keep increasing production. Then my marginal, I notice one thing, my marginal product of labor actually keeps falling. Initially it was 50 units, then 40, then 30, 20, 10.
Mm-hmm.
Now I find one parallel here from our consumption theory. That is, remember we talked about the marginal utility of consumption.
Marginal utility, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now, and we also discussed that after a point, the marginal utility keeps falling,
diminishing.
Exactly, exactly like that we find.
Hmm.
We find in a very peculiar situation here.
Hmm.
If you have one factor of production fixed, and if you keep varying the other factor of production, initially, hmm, the marginal product will be high.
Hmm.
After that, it keeps falling. And that's exactly the parallel that we find from demand theory as well. So, and the cost to workers will keep increasing as I hire more and more workers.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So my total cost also increases.
Mm-hmm.
My fixed cost remains same.
Mm-hmm.
But my variable cost, that is the labor wages, keeps increasing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, let me just…
unit cost. So, per pizza, if you look at it, it will look much more interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. We'll see how, that. Yeah,
okay,
how that concept comes, mm-hmm, in. So, this we can plot.
Hmm.
In terms of quantity of production and the number of workers hired, and we can have a relationship.
Correct.
So that's a very simple kind of a production function, to which we will come later on in our discussions when we try and.
So what is this production function is?
Production function is the kind of a relationship between inputs and outputs.
In this case, output pizzas.
Output is pizzas, and input is worker I have put.
Only worker.
Only worker.
That you're considering.
Only that I'm considering. Variable.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Uh-huh. Okay. Now. Now let us come to this whole example again in terms of the total cost curve. See, this is the total cost. Initially it was 30, 40, 50, 60, it goes. So the total cost curve is always an increasing curve.
Hmm.
Even though your fixed cost is the same, your variable cost is increasing.
Hmm.
So that will pull up this. So it's always an increasing curve.
Hmm.
Okay. Let us look at this in terms of per unit and things of that sort, which will give us a better picture then. So, total cost then is fixed. It is not varying.
Hmm.
Variable cost keeps changing,
hmm,
because here I'm not talking of a pizza. I'm talking of a very simple example of a lime juice whatever shop. And for producing one unit of lime juice, I have this initial whatever lemons and whatever kind of a lemonade baking unit and things of that sort. But the variable cost keeps increasing. Then we can compute the average fixed cost. Then we can compute the average variable cost. Average fixed cost is nothing but total cost by the total units produced.
Which will keep decreasing.
Which will keep decreasing.
There's only one item.
Only one time you are actually investing. Average variable cost is very, very interesting. Initially, you know, it keeps, it is less, but then it keeps increasing. Because you are adding more and more workers.
When you add one more worker, it will again fall.
It
will increase. It will step function increase.
Yes. So, we find that from 0.3, 0.4, 0.5, 0.6, 0.7, it keeps increasing.
Okay. All right.
So, we have the average total cost, which is nothing but average fixed cost plus average variable cost.
Variable cost.
Okay. But then we also remember when we started our discussion, we made this point that a lot of decisions are made at the margin. So, if I have to make a decision as to, now I am producing three units or three glasses per hour, should I increase the output to 5 or 6, at the margin, what is my cost? So, we introduce a concept called marginal cost. And marginal cost is very interesting because we find that marginal cost also keeps increasing. That is because the variable cost keeps increasing. So, the marginal cost is pulled up. Now, let us put everything in a perspective. Then we will see this in terms of, you know,
variable cost keeps increasing, but the increase may not be necessarily at the same rate as the number of items produced.
Yeah. So
per item it might actually be
reducing. Then at that point I will have to decide whether should I expand my production or not. That is the point that I was trying to come and So I am plotting all this into a slightly clumsy graph.
Okay.
Yeah. Now we have the average fixed cost. It keeps falling. Right. We have the average variable cost. It keeps increasing. Average fixed cost and average variable cost will give us the average total cost.
Sum of the average fixed cost and average variable cost.
Yes.
Is the average total cost.
Yeah. Okay. And we have the marginal cost.
Which is also increasing.
Which is increasing.
Right.
Now, depending on this, I will decide where I should locate my production.
Okay, how do you
do that? There are two curves. I will come to that in a minute. Yeah.
But the shape of these curves are typical. I mean,
these are typical.
Because, I mean, the reason why this average fixed cost is coming down is because the fixed cost number is constant.
Yeah. Production
is on increasing the production. So, it's a 1 by x kind of function.
Yes.
1 by x, right?
Yes.
So, that is why you are seeing this curve which is like this 1 by x function.
Yes.
Whereas the average variable cost is kind of linearly related to the number of items you're producing.
Yeah.
So it will be a linear curve, increasing line.
It's an increasing function.
Line, increasing
function.
And so you have a 1 by x curve.
Yeah.
And you have a x. So you have alpha x plus beta 1 by x.
Yes.
1 by x, alpha.
Yes.
So you add up, one curve is decreasing, one curve is increasing.
Yeah.
So you add up, you'll get something which will either, it will come and go like this.
So like this. And that takes place at a particular point in production process.
Ah, so you're getting this kind of curve.
Yeah.
Because initially it is dominated by the fixed cost.
Yeah. And then?
Then it gets dominated by the variable,
cost. So, we have to decide where we should locate our production.
Okay. I understand. This average total cost is sum of average fixed cost and variable cost.
Yeah.
So, it's x plus 1 by x plus x. Something times 1 by x plus something else times x.
Yes.
That kind of function.
Yes.
Okay.
Now, okay. So when we plot this then, I will just take one more minute. So, at a particular point, we need to decide whether we should locate the production or not. Because
in this case, it looks like 4 or 5 or something.
Yeah. Look at this region. This region looks, you know, pretty okay for me because here I can actually take advantage of this falling cost.
You get that. I may have to draw.
Yeah.
So this region is saying, Okay.
Yeah. But so here I can take advantage of this falling curve. But if I move to this region, I will have to face the rising curve. So at a particular point, I have to. So here at that point where this marginal cost actually, you know, intersects the total cost, I will locate my production and I will stop
That is the point. So that point, interesting point is the point where the marginal cost crosses the total cost.
Average
total cost curve.
Yes. Beyond that production, I have to really think, why should I really operate at an increasing part of this cost curve?
Right.
Again, it is flat and it's slowly increasing.
Okay. Understand.
So
that's like, in this case, it is like five units.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, when we go back to the numbers, yeah, the total total cost is 6.5 here.
Mm.
Total fixed cost is 3.
Mm.
Variable cost is 3.5.
Mm.
The average fixed cost is 0.6.
Mm.
And average variable cost is 0.7.
Mm.
And the average total cost is 1.3.
Mm.
Yeah. Now, beyond this, average variable cost keeps actually increasing.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
So, initially it is high.
Mm.
Then it comes down.
Increasing.
Yeah. Then there is a stable region, 1.3. After that, 1.33, 1.38, 1.43. So then in the U-shaped, you're going to the other part of the U.
Mm-hmm.
So as a rational producer, I will stop production at this part in terms of this 5 units or 6 units. Beyond that, I wouldn't like to supply to the market. Because from a cost efficiency point of view, it is not an efficient production region for me.
Okay.
So that is the advantage of putting this in terms of this formal.
So the key thing is, what you're saying is that just like the consumer keeps maximizing utility.
Yeah.
By looking at the consumption basket, playing around with various things to consume.
Yeah.
So that their utility is maximized.
Yeah.
The producer's job basically is to minimize cost or to manage cost.
Yes.
In the same way.
Yes.
So they will look at various factors of production and
locate your quantities in that region.
That region where
the cost efficiency is maximum.
Yeah.
So that's a very important decision for a firm.
Mm-hmm.
But actually, in real examples, a lot of firms get into this euphoria of expansion.
Mm.
And they forget this. They keep expanding. Suddenly they realize that, look, we have moved to the inefficient region. Then they start trimming and cutting. And that's when we see a lot of, workers being retrenching. Right. What we call as, earlier we used to use the term downsizing, but now we use the term right sizing of the firm and all is in terms of getting it back to this region. Why? Because my variable costs are high. So let me cut the variable costs a little and bring it to
sell off some assets.
Sell off some assets and then, get into the efficient production region.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Now here we need to bring in two more concepts. That is basically, what is this short run and long run that we talk about in production?
Mm.
In the long run, there is no fixed cost. Everything is variable. That time horizon is called the long run.
Okay.
It may be 5 years, it may be 10 years, it may be 15 years, depending on the industry that we are talking about.
Because the fixed cost has become so small.
Yeah.
Number of items you produce is so large. That dividing the fixed cost by that large number of items, fixed cost has become almost zero.
So I can.
So the only curve, basically the curve is dominated now by the variable cost at this time.
In the long run. Yeah.
Yeah.
In the short run, fixed costs
is very dominant.
Is dominant and you don't have the resources also to alter this fixed cost.
Mm.
If you have to alter the fixed cost, you have to buy another plant and machinery.
Mm.
So you don't have the resources also. In the long run, you might have the resources.
Right.
So if I see that the demand is actually going to increase in the long run, I might actually set up another plant. Mm. Somewhere else.
Mm. Mm.
So that difference, we need to note that there is a difference between short run and long run. In the long run, everything is variable.
Mm.
In the short run, there is something fixed and something variable.
Mm.
Now, what we call as a long run cost is nothing but an envelope of the short run costs. So there are different short run costs. This is one short run cost. This is another short run cost. This is another short run cost.
Mm.
In the long run, all these are put into one cost curve because everything is variable.
Mm.
In the long run. So this envelope curve, then we have to again locate production in this region of the envelope curve to be efficient in the long run. Now, this distinction between long run and short run is extremely important because it depends on the industry, A. B, it also depends on the quantum of fixed costs that the industry needs.
So here you're doing an expansionist modular, I presume, right? You're saying we'll start with a small factory.
Yeah.
And then as the demand goes, we
move to another factory. Medium factory. And then we become a large factory. Yeah.
So that is why you get three curves.
Yeah.
And now you're, because you've made this decision over capital over a period of time.
I'm putting it into one.
Putting it into one curve, which is the envelope curve.
Yeah.
Envelope curve.
Yeah. So this is broadly in terms of what we call as an expansion path of a firm. Yeah. Mm. Okay. Now, given this then, yeah, you can actually bring in three concepts here in terms of production. This region of production is the falling part of the cost curve. We call it as the economies of scale.
That is the first part, where it is declining.
Yeah.
The cost curve, total cost curve is declining is economy of scale because.
So, economies of scale then is defined in terms of as and when your production increases, yeah, the average total cost keeps falling.
Falling. Okay.
Average total cost, not the total cost, average total cost keeps falling. So, as and when your production is actually increasing because of some factors. It could be the way in which you are using your inputs are much efficient. It could be some cost advantages. When you expand production, you might buy material in bulk, which could give you some cost advantages. So, if you are locating at this falling part of this cost curve, then we have economies of scale, a phenomenon where your average total cost keep falling when your output expands. Then you reach a stage where there is what we call as constant return to scale. That is, for one unit of production, I need one unit of cost.
Right.
One-to-one relationship. That's fine. Firms would like to operate there. Even though firms would like to reap this, you cannot keep on reaping this all the time. Because if you have to keep reaping economies of scale, you have to be highly innovative. And only such firms can actually be in that part of the cost curve.
Right.
Most of the firms would operate in this constant returns to scale region.
Right.
We'll come back to it when we talk about, you know, production decisions of firm a little more. But this is a very important concept because firms wouldn't like to move to this diseconomies of scale. What is diseconomies of scale? As and when I increase output, my average total cost keeps increasing by a factor which is more than this output increase. So, a 2% increase in output would result in a 5% or a 6% increase in cost. That's not a very comfortable region. So, that is where the firm would like to come back to this constant returns to scale kind of a thing. So, production planning then is actually very, very related, very much related to your cost analysis. And that is what we try to demonstrate here with a very simple two concepts of cost, that is fixed and variable cost, and average cost and marginal costs. Okay.